Okay, hello everyone, and welcome to the second part of the topic hypoplastic and neoplastic disorders of the oral cavity. So just to take you through once again the learning outcomes, by the end of this topic, you should be able to identify and describe hypoplastic lesions of the oral mucosa, name one benign and malignant connective tissue tumor involving the fibrous tissue, adipose tissue, vascular tissue, peripheral nerves, and muscles. Describe in brief clinical features of common hypoplastic and neoplastic disorders. And lastly, illustrate the histopathology of pyogenic granuloma, peripheral ossifying fibroma, peripheral giant cell granuloma, fibroepithelial polyp, lipoma, hemangioma, neurilemoma, neurofibroma, and fibrosarcoma. Right? So, in the last class, we have discussed about the hypoplastic lesions of the oral cavity, right? Starting with epulis. And moving on to cover fibroepithelial polyp, focal fibrous hyperplasia, denture hyperplasia, papillary hyperplasia of the palate. Okay, so let's now move on to the neoplastic lesions of the oral cavity. So as I have actually mentioned during our discussions for the case-based learning, this topic basically focuses primarily on the neoplastic lesion, the connective tissue neoplasms of the oral cavity. All right. So benign variety of benign and malignant connective tissue neoplasms do occur in the oral cavity. They are quite rare, but they do occur. Clinically, most benign neoplasms present as growths, as submucosal swellings, okay, commonly called as lumps and bumps. Okay, they are quite indistinguishable from hypoplastic lesions, and histopathological evaluation is necessary for diagnostic confirmation. Okay, so this is here is a table here for you to be able to understand the category of the various connective tissues, the benign tumor that arises from this category of tissues, and the corresponding malignant tumor. Okay, so I'm sure you know benign tumor of fibrous origin will be called fibroma. The malignant counterpart is called fibrosarcoma. Adipose tissue, the benign lesion is called lipoma. The malignant counterpart is called liposarcoma. Vascular tissue is called hemangioma. Okay, and the malignant counterpart is called hemangiosarcoma, Kaposi sarcoma, so on and so forth. Tumors of peripheral nerve, based on the cell of origin, there we have benign tumors called neurofibroma, neurilemoma, right? And the malignant counterparts are called malignant peripheral nerve sheath tumors. Okay, basically neurofibroma gives rise to neurofibrosarcoma, and so on. Okay, lastly, the tumor of muscle. Okay, the most common one is leiomyomas, which is the benign tumor of smooth muscle, and its malignant counterpart is called leiomyosarcoma. Right, rhabdomyosarcoma, on the other hand, is the malignant tumor of striated muscle.
Let's
origin.
Start off with looking
okay.
at some of the lesions that are important for you, that you should know, and are maybe frequent in terms of those in terms of the cases that you see in clinic. All right. So lipomas. Let's start with lipoma here. So lipomas are benign, slow-growing tumors consisting of mature fat cells. Right. Their adipose tissue in their origin is adipose tissue. They're uncommon in the oral cavity. That means rarely in 1 out of 5,000 adults we see a lipoma. Oral lesions are small, less than 3 centimeters, commonly seen on the tongue, floor of the mouth, buccal mucosa, gingiva, mucobuccal folds, mucobuccal or labial folds. Okay, they're roughly classified as superficial and this is a clinical picture here of a little bump on the mucosa here, which on doing the biopsy turned out to be a lipomatous tissue. Okay, so lipomas are the histopathology when what differentiates it from any other hypoplastic or neoplastic lesion in the oral cavity. Will show a thin fibrous capsule, mature adipocytes mixed with fibrous strands. Okay. And of course, there are various different types. This is just good to know information. Okay, you don't need to specifically delve into the specific details here. So there are various types: fibrolipoma, angiolipoma, mixolipoma, osteolipoma, and spindle cell lipoma, all depending on the major component that is seen in addition to the adipose cells, right? So fibrolipoma means there is a large fibrous component. Angio means there is a vascular component. Myxo means there's myxoid tissue. Osteoid means there is bone. And spindle cell lipoma means you're seeing a large number of spindle cell component in. Right. So this is a typical histopathological presentation of a lipoma. This is the fibrous capsule here that you're seeing. And this is the mature adipocytes that show no dysplastic features in them. Okay, moving on, the next one is hemangiomas, alright? So these are tumors of endothelial cell origin which develop within the first month of life and involute over a period of time, okay? That means as the child progresses in age and development, these lesions, that is hemangiomas, they shrink in size and eventually become very small. Okay, there are three types: capillary, cavernous, and mixed. Basically, based on the component of, or rather, the size of the blood vessel that you see. So, capillaries are small blood vessels. Cavernous hemangiomas have large vascular spaces in them, and the mixed is a mixture of both. So, the second term that you should be familiar with is called vascular malformations. All right. So, vascular malformations are tumors of venous, arterial, or lymphatic origin. Okay, so when it's a tumor of endothelial origin, it's called a hemangioma. But when it's a tumor of venous, arterial, or lymphatic origin, and which is present at birth and continues to grow with the child, that's when it's called a vascular malformation, right? So this is very important. It's a very important concept, and you need to know here. Hemangiomas, they involute, and over a period of time, they're present at they develop within the first month of life and involute over a period of time, whereas vascular malformations are present at birth and continue to grow with the child. Okay, now there are venous malformations, capillary malformations, intravenous malformations, and lymphatic malformations. Okay, these are two important lesions and terminologies that you need to know. Okay, so this is a picture here of a hemangioma, right, on the dorsal surface of the tongue, right? So it's clearly visible that the lesion is a small bump over the surface of the tongue, which is of reddish purplish color, right? And the size is much smaller. Okay, much smaller. So as we've just gone through the explanation of the terminologies, hemangiomas basically arise 1 month after birth, and then eventually as the child grows, they involute and then disappear, right? So this is where you can clearly see that the size of the lesion has over many years become smaller and smaller in size. Okay. Intravenous vascular malformation, wherein this lesion would have been small in size when the child would have been born, and as the child is growing, the lesion is becoming bigger and bigger in size. So that's the difference between a hemangioma and a vascular malformation. Vascular malformations could be malformations of lymphatics, could be malformations of the venous system, could be malformations of the arterial system. Okay, thank you. So oral hemangiomas, they are benign neoplasms arising from blood vessels manifesting as flat or raised red-purple surface discoloration, right? Just like the picture that we just saw. They're seen in children, right? They're flat or raised red lesions that may blanch under pressure, right? Now, what do you mean by the word blanch? So the word blanch means that when you apply pressure on the lesion, okay? When you apply pressure on the lesion becomes pale, okay? And the right way to do this is using a glass slab and placing it over the lesion and pressing it. Okay, so when I say glass slide, not exactly a slab, a glass slide, right? A small glass slide which is used, and then you apply uniform pressure over the lesion, and the lesion appears becoming pale, indicating that basically the blood, when pressure is applied to the lesion, the blood that's there inside the lesion moves out and thus appears pale. Okay, now hemangiomas can occur in soft tissue, can occur in heart tissue as well. So we do get intraosseous lesions, which are seen commonly in the mandible as compared to maxilla. Okay. Right, now this is a patient with a large swelling again on the tongue. Okay, if you look carefully at the color of the swelling, it looks reddish purplish in color. Right, I'm sure with such a big mass in the mouth, it's been quite difficult for the patient to chew, to masticate, to speak. Right, and thus the patient has come for seeking for treatment. Now here, this is actually an IOPA of a patient who presented with relucency in the tooth bearing area in the mandibular anterior region, and then upon biopsy it turned out to be a hemangioma, right? A hemangioma. Basically, this slide is basically to make you understand that we can find hemangiomatous lesions in trauma. So many times a jaw lesion like that can only be identified or diagnosed when you do a biopsy, right? So when a biopsy is done, what you could actually see is basically capillary. You can see these large capillaries here, blood-filled capillaries with fibroblast surrounding fibroblastic tissue. Okay, now hemangiomas are commonly associated with certain syndromes. Okay, and two of the most very common syndromes, which is very important for you as an undergraduate student, is number one, Stuch-Weber syndrome, right? And what happens in Stuch-Weber syndrome is there are hemangiomatous lesions on the face all along the branches of the trigeminal nerve. Okay, they are ipsilateral hemangiomas. Okay, sometimes there is calcifications of the leptomeninges in the cerebral cortex, and the patient also has convulsions affecting the limbs of the opposite side of the body, right? So if this patient has this vascular malformation, this hemangiomatous lesion on the right side of his face, he or she does also have convolutions affecting the limbs of the opposite side. So well, if the more two or more of these distinct features are there, then we suspect that the patient has a syndrome called Stuch-Weber syndrome. Okay, Stuch-Weber syndrome. The second is hereditary hemorrhagic telangiectasia. It's also called HHT. The diagnostic criteria are number one, epistaxis, that is bleeding nose, which is spontaneous and recurrent. Telangiectasias, that is there are multiple, at least at characteristic sites, lip, oral cavity, fingers, and nose. So these are telangiectic lesions, basically superficial dilatations of the blood vessels giving rise to pink to red color spots on the skin and mucosa. Okay, visceral lesions such as gastrointestinal telangiectasia or pulmonary, hepatic, cerebral or spinal intravenous malformations. Maybe their history, a positive history of a first degree relative with a similar disorder is generally found in these patients. And this diagnosis is done if three or more of these criteria are present, then definitely it is a diagnosis. If two criteria are present, then it's possibly a diagnosis. If less than two criteria are present, any of these two criteria that we've just discussed, then it is probably something else, not HHT. Okay, now this is the photograph of oral telangiectasias. Okay, so on the inferior lip, and there are multiple telangiectasic lesions. Okay. Okay, so now moving on to benign tumors of the bone. Okay, so a benign tumor of the bone is called an osteoma. Okay, it basically is proliferation of compact or the cancellous bone. Okay, which may be endosteal or periosteal in location, is rarely in soft tissues. Osteomas are rarely seen in soft tissues. Now they are well circumscribed swelling, slow growing, and producing asymmetry. Okay. Since this is a bone forming tumor, radiographically we're going to see radio opacity, okay, radio opaque mass. Histologically we will be seeing compact or cancellous normal bone, right? So benign, that's the beauty of benign tumors. If you are clear with your histological concepts, then it is easy to identify benign tumors, right? And surgical excision is the treatment. So benign tumors of bone, osteomas do occur. Here is an example of an osteoma in the maxilla. All right, lesion here, which is more common than osteoma and is very widely seen in the Malaysian population. All right. Now this is a bony exostosis, okay, which is seen on the palate, and the term that is used is called palatal tori. I'm sure many of you have already seen patients like this in the clinic, or your colleagues also have this. All right. And this is a lingual tori, wherein you are seeing a bony hard overgrowth on the lingual aspect, on the lingual aspect on mandibular, between in the mandibular premolar region. Okay, so these tori are basically classified as hematomatous lesions. So hematomatous lesions are basically a normal proliferation of cells native to the site of origin. Okay, those are called as hematomatous lesions. So here a normal bone tissue is overgrowing from the maxilla of the mandible. Okay, so the difference between a hematoma and a benign tumor is the growth potential. So benign tumors have a specific growth potential, okay, whereas hematomatous do not have a growth potential. Okay, so many a times they are static for many number of years, specifically in this case such as tori, and they are harmless. Okay, benign tumors on the other hand depend on their cell of origin. Okay, right. So palatal tori and lingual tori, they are hematomatous lesions. They are racial, the etiology is racial, hereditary, as well as various environmental factors. There is no evidence of malignant conversion. There are various size and shapes. There are numerous studies being done on the Malaysian population, including one from PIDC. All right, surgical treatments. Its implication is basically surgical treatment before any prosthetic appliance in order to ensure retention of the appliance. One unexpected benefit of having a tori would be that it is a good source for autologous bone graft. Okay, autogenous bone graft. Right. Okay, let's look at the next lesion, which is neurofibroma, which is a benign tumor of nerve tissue origin. Okay, so it's a benign tumor of the peripheral nerve origin arising from Schwann cells. Okay, so there are two components here. One is a Schwann cell and the other is a perineural fibroblast. So these are solitary, slow growing, soft, painless lesions varying in size. Now skin is a common sight, followed by tongue and the buccal mucosa, which are common sites in the oral cavity. Now, point to be noted here is that sometimes you do find intraosseous neurofibromas as well. Okay, so if we do have a swelling in the buccal mucosa or a tongue, which is solitary, slow growing, soft and painless, obviously what you're going to do based on its features, it looks benign, so you're going to excise it. And when you excise it, if it is a neurofibroma, what are we going to see? We're going to see interlacing bundles of spindle cells shaped with wavy nuclei, right? So the most important difference between fibroblasts and neuro and Schwann cells is the fact that you see spindle shaped cells, but you see wavy nuclei, okay, with pointed ends. Other than that, you see collagen bundles and few myxoid areas, right? Mast cells are numerous. This is a diagnostic feature, right? So this is something. So here we have a patient here with a large swelling in the tongue. Okay, it looks like surely looks like a swelling in the substance. So this is the surgery that was done. This is photographs have been taken from a journal. Okay, online. And following the excision, mass about 2.5 centimeters by 2.5 centimeters was retrieved. Microscopically, what you can see is, first of all, let me start from the top. This is the fibrous capsule that you are seeing on top, right? This is the tumor mass that you are seeing over here. And this tumor mass, if you look carefully, is composed of two different types of cells. One is the Schwann cell, or the nerve cell of origin, and the other is the perineural fibroblast, right? So fibroblasts, you identify them, they are basically plump and spindle shaped. So these are all the fibroblasts, right? These are the fibroblasts, whereas the distinctive type of thin, wavy, spindle shaped cells with wavy nuclei, which is seen here, as well as on the arrow marks over here. Those are the Schwann cells. There are two components here, the neural component and the perineural fibroblast. Okay. Along an important condition which we must learn in detail when we learn about neurofibromas is something called as neurofibromatosis. And this is also called von Recklinghausen's disease of skin, or NF1. It is an autosomal dominant condition with a gene mutation at the loci 17q11.2. Okay. Now, usually at this point, I take the opportunity to actually explain to students what exactly is the meaning of this nomenclature. Okay. Now, okay, let me use my pointer here. So let's try and use a pen. Okay, so all of us do know that we all have chromosomes, right? And each of it is basically based on chromatids like this, right? And we have two pairs of them, and most of these chromosomes have a long arm and a short arm. Okay, so first of all, this denotes the chromosome number, right? 17 denotes the, let me try and write it well, chromosome number. Okay, Q stands for basically the long arm. So basically there are two, the nomenclature is basically called the French, American and British nomenclature, wherein the French use the word P to for petite, which is denoted by the short arm, and the Q, which the British and the American described as just the opposite, so that they could just call it Q for the long arm. Okay, so if it's 17p, that means it's chromosome number p 17, short arm of chromosome number 17, and this is the locus. Okay, whereas here in this case is 17q, so it's chromosome number 17, long arm. Now 11.2 means basically when karyotyping is done, basically you these chromosomes basically have bands and light bands and dark bands and so on and so forth. So basically it is indicative of the 11th band. Basically 11th band, this is the band, and 2 is further on a subband. So basically this is the address. Okay, so when we talk of these nomenclatures, what we're trying to say is these are basically the address of the location of the chromosome where there is a defect corresponding to a defect in a protein which is leading to a particular disease. All right, so that's the central dogma of molecular biology, right? Okay, and this is how these patients present with. Okay, so patients who have this genetic mutation on 17q11.2, which leads to the condition called neurofibromatosis, this is how they present with. Okay, so basically they have multiple neurofibromatous lesions all along on their skin, right? I'm sure you will agree with me that this is very can have a very very various other serious psychological impact conditions patients that, that it comes along with. Okay, so there are diagnostic criteria to come up with to diagnose a case of neurofibromatosis. Number one is 6 or more cafe ole macules over 5 millimeters in prepubertal and greater than 15 millimeters in postpubertal patients. Okay, I will tell you what are cafe ole pigmentations. I think you all know. Basically, cafe ole means coffee in milk, like. Appearance is very clearly evident. These macules are very clearly evident in fair-skinned individuals. Okay. The second criteria is 2 or more neurofibromas or 1 plexiform neurofibroma. Plexiform neurofibroma is a histological presentation. Okay, it has specific clinical features as well. Okay, it's a type of neurofibroma.
freckling in the axillary or inguinal region is the third criteria. Fourth is optic gliomas. Okay, fifth is two or more leech nodules. These leech nodules are basically, again, gelatinous overgrowth seen on the iris. Okay. Sixth is a distinctive osseous lesion. Example is sphenoid dysplasia or thinning of long bone cortex. And seventh is a first degree relative, right? So these are very important seven diagnostic criteria, which are indicative of a patient who is suffering from neurofibromatosis type 1. So this is a slide that actually shows various diagnostic criteria that we just discussed. So number one is this is the leech nodules. All right, this is the axillary freckling that you notice. So freckling is basically again noticed in fair skin individuals very nicely. Okay, these are multiple neurofibromas. Okay, these are very initial compared to the one that I just showed you. Okay, these are the cafe olea pigmentation that are seen over here, and this is the sphenoid dysplasia that is seen on this 3D CBCT that is shown. Okay, so the next lesion is neurilemomas. Okay, so unlike neurofibromas, neurilemomas are derived only from Schwann cells. Okay, so there is no fibrous component over here. There is no fibroblastic component over here. Okay, so this is purely from the Schwann cells. So these are slow growing tumors, occur at any age. There is no gender predilection. They can occur in soft tissues and they can occur in the bone. And intraorally, they're more common again in the tongue, followed by the palate, floor of the mouth, buccal mucosa, gingiva, lip, and the vestibule. So this here again is a swelling on the lingual aspect of mandibular anterior teeth. Okay, if you have to give a differential diagnosis based on the clinical presentation as well as inspectory and palpatory finding, you could list out literally most of the benign neoplastic lesions that we have discussed so far. So differentiated would be the histopathological appearance. So histopathologically, it's an encapsulated tumor composed of two types of cells. Okay, now this is described as Antony A type, okay, where the tissue is made up of elongated and spindle-shaped nuclei in palisading arrangement with intercellular fibers arranged in parallel walls. I'll show you on the next slide. And an Antony B type tissue, which shows disorderly arrangement of cells and fibers with edema and microcyst formation. Okay, so the easiest way to remember is one is an organized area of tissue, the other is a disorganized area of tissue. And in between, you do see some acellular hyaline structures. Hyaline means eosinophilic. Acellular means without any cells, which are called as Verrucchia bodies. Right. So this is the Antony A type area and Antony B type area. Slide over here. So this is basically the palisaded arrangement of cells. Palisading means parallel arrangement of cells. So if you look at this structure, this is described as Verrucchia bodies. This arrangement of nuclei around these Verrucchia bodies is described as Antony A type cells. Okay, another area of the slide where you see a disorganized arrangement of cells, that would be the Antony B cell. Okay, that is about neurilemomas. Okay, right, moving on, let's look at malignant tumors of connective tissue origin. The most important one is fibrosarcoma. Okay, so fibrosarcomas are basically malignant tumor of fibroblast origin. 10% of them occur in the head and neck. They are slow growing masses reaching considerable sizes, common in young adults and children. Okay, so here you can see a clinical photograph of a large mass that is displacing also the teeth and has also is expansile. You can see the displacement of teeth even on the radiograph over here, right? So in this case, obviously we have to do a biopsy to confirm our diagnosis before we can progress with the treatment. Okay, so histopathology, when a biopsy is done for these lesions, we would see it would consist of fascicles or spindle-shaped cells that are classically form a herringbone pattern. I'm going to explain that to you.
So because it's a malignant tumor, we are going to see pleomorphism and mitotic figures, because which is characteristic of a malignant transformation in a fibroblast. Okay, so they're graded as well, moderate and poorly differentiated. So this pattern, which is classically described as hairy bone pattern, is a pattern consisting of adjoining vertical rows of slanting lines, any two contiguous lines forming a V or an inverted. So this is how it looks. So this is a herringbone, basically a fish bone, okay, wherein you see the arrangement of the bones along the perpendicular spine in a V-shaped arrangement. The same thing here in terms of a pattern on a cloth. Okay, so if you look at this slide carefully, you can see that arrangement even here. Okay, let me try and show you. This is how it looks, right? So this is a central line with the slide, with the cells arranged in V-shaped arrangement, okay, even visible all along, right? Even visible all along. So this is now the classical herringbone pattern. Additionally, when you look carefully, you can see that the nuclei are showing hyperchromatism, right? There is mitosis over here, and there is different size and shape of cells, which indicate pleomorphism, which indicates that this is not a benign lesion but is a malignant tissue, malignancy of fibroblast origin called fibrosarcoma. And yes, this is how it looks. Okay, that's the comparison here of the herringbone with it. Yeah, so this is where I wanted to show you mitosis here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? So this is the herringbone pattern and arrangement of the fibroblasts and the pleomorphism and the mitosis that you can see in the fibroblasts. Okay, so compare this image to the image of fibroblasts that you see in the normal connective tissue, right? So there it looks very banal, but here it looks very dangerous, right? So that is how a malignant tumor of fibroblast origin will look like under the microscope. Okay, so the treatment for these cases would be wide surgical excision or resection along with neck dissection. Okay, most sarcomas have very, very poor prognosis. Usually the 5-year survival rate is only 40 to 70%. Okay, so carcinomas, as compared to carcinomas, sarcomas are more dangerous, more rapidly spreading, and have a very poor prognosis. Okay, so that brings us to the end of this topic. I hope you have understood the core concepts. Further on, we will discuss most of these cases also as part of case-based learning.